Good morning and welcome to worship on behalf of the Angustandian Perthshire Methodist Circuit here in Scotland. My name is the Reverend Nick Willer and I'm leading worship for you this morning. Let us join together to worship God, the source of all love, compassion and justice, as we seek to become fit to do God's will in the world. Amen.
Love to sing your praises.
I lift your name on high. Lord, I love to sing your praises. I'm so glad you're in my life. I'm so glad you came to save us. You came from heaven to earth to show
pray. O Lord, you are our God, the God of Abraham, Isaac and Joseph, the God of Moses, the prophets and psalmists, the God of priests, Levites and Samaritans, the God of disciples and apostles, the God of Jews and Gentiles, the God of the good, the bad and the ugly. O Lord, you are our God, and your promises to us are immense, beyond our imagining, beyond what we deserve. You are our God, and we adore you for all you are, and for all your ways, and for all your love, this and every day. Almighty God, in a world of so many choices, with so many options, so many routes to take and roads to follow, we give you thanks that in the mix of life you are there. You are here with us and always will be. We give you thanks that you've inspired so many people to live their lives with love and support and generosity. We give you thanks that you have set hearts on fire with passion and commitment to serve you and our neighbours in the way that you would have us do. We give thanks that we can read and share your word, know your truth, feel your peace, and have the freedom to choose right from wrong. For this and so much more, we give you thanks and praise. But we confess, Lord, that there are times when we have tried to trap you. God, forgive us for the times when we've seen a need but walked on by. Lord, forgive us for times when we felt too important to get involved, for times when we've been in too much of a rush, for times when we have simply ignored a need. Lord, forgive us for times when we've not done what is right. Lord, forgive us for times when we've acted cruelly or unjustly. Lord, forgive us. Lift from us, Lord, the burdens of guilt, of sorrow for deeds undone, of pain for harm and hurt caused. Blessed be you, Lord God, who takes away the sins of the world, who has lightened our load, cleansed us and forgiven us. These prayers we offer in the name of your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord and Saviour. Amen.
Luke chapter 10, verses 25 to 37. The Parable of the Good Samaritan. On one occasion, an expert in the law stood up to test Jesus. "Teacher," he asked, "what must I do to inherit eternal life?" "What is written in the law?" he replied. "How do you read it?" He answered, "Love the Lord your God with all your heart, and with all your soul, and with all your strength, and with all your mind, and love your neighbor as yourself." "You have answered correctly," Jesus replied. "Do this, and you will live." But he wanted to justify himself, so he asked Jesus, "And who is my neighbor?" In reply, Jesus said, "A man was going down from Jerusalem to Jericho when he fell into the hands of robbers. They stripped him of his clothes, beat him, and went away, leaving him half dead. A priest happened to be going down the same road, and when he saw the man, he passed by on the other side. So too a Levite, when he came to the place and saw him, passed by on the other side. But a Samaritan, as he traveled, came where the man was, and when he saw him, he took pity on him. He went to him and bandaged his wounds, pouring on oil and wine. Then he put the man on his own donkey, took him to an inn, and took care of him. The next day he took out 2 silver coins and gave them to the innkeeper. "Look after him," he said, "and when I return I will reimburse you for any extra expense you may have." Which of these 3 do you think was a neighbor to the man who fell into the hands of robbers? The expert in the law replied, "The one who had mercy on him." Jesus told him, "Go and do likewise."
The parable that we heard from the Gospel of Luke is certainly the most widely known of all the stories Jesus told. Even the least churched among society recognise it. The language of the Good Samaritan is part of our culture's working vocabulary. For an example, we have an entire section of legal code known as Good Samaritan laws. They help protect from liability anyone who chooses to help another person in some kind of distress. Their intent is to encourage bystanders to offer assistance to strangers in need, to be good Samaritans. It's an important and noble objective, but it also represents a simplistic interpretation that misses most of the complexity and richness of the story. The story says much more than the laws. When I was at theological college, as part of a fascinating and very practical course on death and dying, I served as shadowing chaplain at a local hospital. My only responsibility was to shadow the chaplain during the late night hours each Thursday. One Thursday, I arrived to find the chaplain standing in the office doorway, coat on, bag in her hand, a family emergency. She'll be back soon as she could, and in the meantime, here's the pager. You'll know what to do. 30 relatively quiet minutes later, the pager lit up. I made the call. A man had just died and the family was asking for the chaplain. I gathered my strength and walked towards the lift. I remember the feelings of inadequacy and fear that overwhelmed me. What would I say to comfort a family that had just lost a father, a husband, a grandfather? What were the magic words they needed to hear from me? Which textbook example would best fit this real-world situation? As I arrived outside the intensive care unit, I found 6 family members gathered. After introducing myself, I froze. What would I say next? The man standing next to me said, "He was a good man and a great father. He worked so hard, but he always had time for us." Another family member chimed in with a story about a family holiday. Everyone laughed over the time they'd convinced this straight-laced grandfather to ride a roller coaster with his granddaughter. "Do you remember when?" And the stories kept coming. 2 hours later, the family graciously thanked me for coming, though all I'd done was listen. And as I walked out of the waiting room, I promised myself that I would never forget the power of stories to recreate, comfort and give hope even in the most difficult of times. So when we encounter Jesus in the 10th chapter of Luke, he's on his way to the cross. The writer of the Gospel has made it perfectly clear in the previous chapter with the ominous line, "He set his face to go to Jerusalem." Jesus is headed for the holy city. This journey and the people Jesus meets along the way provide the backdrop for many of his most memorable stories. Today, ours begins with a lawyer, an expert in the law of Moses, who stands up to test Jesus. Like the Pharisees, who were his colleagues, the lawyer wants to know if Jesus will probably use the Torah to answer this weighty question. "What must I do to inherit eternal life? Chapter and verse, please." But this is Jesus. This is the Gospel of Luke. Anyone expecting or demanding a direct answer is bound to be disappointed. Instead, Jesus answers the question with another question. "What is written in the law? What do you read there that might address your question?" Now perhaps Jesus wants to respond to the test offered by the lawyer with a test of his own, to see if the lawyer really knows what's in the law. A kind of bar exam, pop quiz. Perhaps this is his goal. But it seems to me that the question serves a much deeper purpose. It invites the lawyer a little closer, forcing him to put his cards on the table. The invitation to dialogue recognises relationships and mutuality. What do you think is the answer? Of all the intimidating and anxiety-producing settings in which I've spoken, there's none that matches the appointment I used to have in my previous circuit while we were out without a minister. On the second Wednesday of each month at 9:15 in the morning, preschool chapel. On one visit, I began our time together by asking the children a question. "What do you want to be when you grow up?" The answers were wonderful. Lots of teachers and firefighters, a pirate and a princess in the crowd. But then one of the 4-year-olds raised her hand. "Nick, what do you want to be when you grow up?" There was something so wonderful and terrifying about having my question returned to me, invited to join the conversation, compelled to take a stand. "What must I do to inherit eternal life?" the lawyer asks. "You tell me," Jesus responds. "Since we're dealing with a legal professional, we can expect a thoughtful answer," as if he'd been waiting for the opportunity all along. The lawyer quickly combines 2 different verses of Hebrew scripture and ends up with a comprehensive statement of proper ethical conduct. "You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul and with all your strength, and with all your mind, and love your neighbour as yourself." Jesus applauds the answer, but he's not finished with the answerer. So he pulls his conversation partner just a little closer to a place where proper words and proper actions meet and offers a surprisingly simple summary statement. Do this and you will live. At this point in the encounter, we've come to a crossroads for the lawyer. Either he'll roll his eyes, thank Jesus for this apparently fruitless conversation and move on, or he'll take the bait. Well, the lawyer is hooked. We know this because Luke takes some time to share the intentions behind his questions. The purpose of his initial question, what must I do to inherit eternal life, was to test Jesus. But this time around, the question has a different purpose. He wants to justify himself. Though the word justify is most often read with a tone of self-righteousness, it doesn't have to be that way. The lawyer no longer wants to test Jesus. He wants to test himself. How can I be justified? Who is my neighbour? The question has an air of urgency, and Jesus responds with a story. And he told the crowds all these things in parables. Without a parable, he told them nothing. The gospel writer Matthew got it right. When Jesus confronts a heavy question, he doesn't do so with prepositional assertions or creedal statements, but through the telling of stories. So let me tell you a story. A sower went out to sow. Someone gave a great dinner and invited many guests. It is as if there are some truths so profound that only a story can describe them, so personal and transformational that only a story will convey the message. A story has the capacity to create community, to reshape the alert and invested hearer. Just before bedtime, the young child turns to her grandfather. Tell me a story. What kind of story would you like to hear? He asks. One with me in it. Jesus tells this lawyer a story. One with his new best friend in it. Two experts in the Torah walk by a beaten and nearly dead man on the side of the road. They know the commandments to love God and neighbour, even have them memorised. But they don't stop to help a stranger at the point of death. The twist comes with the third traveller. A Samaritan, an outsider, one whose interpretation of Leviticus and Deuteronomy make the lawyer's blood boil. The Samaritan shows the man in need hospitality and kindness, and mercy and generosity in the extreme. Two perfect stand-ins for our inquisitive lawyer walk right by, and his sworn theological enemy does the right thing. The lawyer had requested a definition of neighbour. He receives a description of mercy. The story hits very close to home, exposing the distance between answers and actions. The lawyer is left with the most soul-searching question of all. Which of these three do you think was a neighbour to the man who fell into the hands of the robbers? On the surface, it's an easy question. The Samaritan, of course. But that's not what the lawyer says. His answer is now broader because of his understanding of the question. The one who showed him mercy. This general description of a very specific character leaves the door open for the lawyer. Perhaps he too could be the Samaritan. What was unthinkable only moments ago is now a possibility. Because of the story, everything can be different. The lawyer can change roles. He can go and do likewise. We need to remember now more than ever that we're followers of Jesus Christ. Our art is storytelling. Our deepest truths begin with phrases like, there was a man who had two sons, or a man was going from Jerusalem to Jericho. We're called to tell the story of Jesus Christ and how his story has changed ours. These ancient stories of Scripture are so powerful because we are in them. They encounter us where we are and they transform us. We're not told how the dialogue between Jesus and the lawyer ended. I like to imagine a new disciple following Jesus down the road to Jerusalem, sharing the story that changed his life with every person he meets. At the church where I grew up, we used to sing that beautiful hymn, Tell Me the Old, Old Story. Tell me the old, old story of unseen things above, of Jesus and his glory, of Jesus and his love. Tell me the story simply, as to a little child, for I am weak and weary, and helpless and defiled. So clear your throats, sisters and brothers in Christ, friends, siblings, the time has come, it's our turn to tell the old, old stories that still have the power to transform lives and remake our broken world. Amen.
And our prayers of intercession. O Lord, our God, we turn our minds, our thoughts, our prayers to those in need, our neighbours near and far. We know the right thing to do is to pray for those in need. So help us now, as we pray, to be willing to offer a hand of help and friendship wherever we can to those for whom we pray. O Lord our God, we pray for them, our neighbours near and far. For those traumatised through random shootings, unprovoked attacks, senseless, seemingly purposeless acts of maiming and murder, leaving scars, physical and emotional, that will last a lifetime. We pray for those in Ukraine. Their agony goes on and on and on. More attacks, more revelations, more trauma. We pray too for the emergency services that react to such events and pick up the pieces of carnage, mentally and physically. O Lord our God, we pray for them, our neighbours near and far. for our faraway neighbours in Australia, seeing drastic effects of climate change with epic flooding in Sydney, for India and Pakistan, for Afghanistan, all countries seeing chaotic weather patterns. Homes, businesses, infrastructures and livelihoods washed away, along with hopes and dreams of security. O Lord our God, we pray for them, our neighbours near and far. For our neighbours in Ethiopia, Sudan, Nicaragua, Sri Lanka, all facing economic and political crises, living lives and existences we cannot even begin to imagine. O Lord our God, we pray for them, our neighbours near and far. For countries and people still fighting the yo-yoing effects of COVID, for slow rollout of vaccines in some places to wasted vaccines in others, from lack of understanding, from fake news, from fear and ignorance, and some people simply ignoring good advice for the good of others. O Lord our God, we pray for them, our neighbours near and far. We pray for young people coming to the end of summer term and all the changes and chances and challenges that that will involve. New schools, new classes, new friends, new teachers, and for some the stress of waiting for exam results that will determine their next steps. For all those leaving education and stepping out into the world with its uncertainty and their uncertainty. Lord our God, we pray for them, our neighbours near and far. For the increasing number of people worldwide facing uncertainties over finance and housing, with conflicts between eating and heating, may those with too much and more than they can ever need be willing to make sacrifices for those with far too little to meet even basic needs. O Lord our God, we pray for them, our neighbours near and far. And Lord, we pray for those in leadership positions, thinking particularly of the government today and the resignations and the reinstatements and the reappointments. Those of us who feel we have no way of influencing what happens, but yet we know fully that we will be the recipients of whatever chaos or sorting out comes from it. We pray for all those for who life today is a real struggle, for those who do not know for whatever reason what the right thing to do is. O Lord our God, we pray for them, our neighbours near and far. Lord God, accept our prayers, our yearnings, and our hopes for others. Amen. We say together the Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, for ever and ever. Amen. Yeah.
Lord, help us to look for the good in our neighbours. Help us to recognise that neighbourliness goes two ways. Make us gracious as well as generous, receptive to the ideas and perspectives as well as the needs of others, remembering that as we meet them, we meet you. And may the blessing of God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit be with us all evermore. Amen.